Good morning and welcome to Home Church Online here at New Life Christian Center, Christie's Beach, South Australia. My name's Greg and I'm pastor here, and I trust that as we worship God together today that your heart will be blessed and that you'll receive something from God's own hand. Let's open in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your presence. And Lord, we ask that you would touch our hearts by the Holy Spirit today and through your word. Father, open up to us a revelation, a clearer revelation of yourself and your will and purpose for our lives, and help us to understand what you're saying to us through your word, in Jesus' name. Above all, we pray that you'd be glorified and blessed in our worship, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, it's great that you can join us today. And if you go online to our website, you'll find out all of the upcoming events and what's happening in the life of our church. We've got a couple of Christmas services coming up, Carol's Night, and if you want to find out what's happening, then please go to our website, www.newlifeonline.org.au. So into the summer season now, into the Christmas season, and I trust you're going to be blessed over the coming weeks. We'd like to give people opportunity to celebrate our giving today, and of course, if you're giving online, go to our website, to our giving page, and you'll see all the information there about how to give. But every week in our church, and churches right across the world, it's our tradition and it's our call to worship God with their offerings. I love Malachi, the Old Testament prophet, very last book or letter of the Old Testament. And he talks about tithing. He says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. You know, it's God's heart for us to live a blessed life. And, you know, I think there's something about giving that draws the best out in us and helps us to walk in the things that God's called us to. And of course, one of those things is to be a generous person, a generous-hearted person, and to use what God has entrusted to us and given to us to be a blessing to others. And of course, as a part of our worship, we give something back to God, from the very things that he's given to us. There's a great promise here that as we give our tithes, then God throws open the floodgates of heaven and pours out so much blessing upon us that we'll not have room enough for it. The problem with the people in Malachi's day is that they'd stopped worshiping God and they were worshiping idols. And one of the clear markers of that was that they'd stopped giving their love offerings to God and their tithes. And so the prophet Malachi calls them back to that, amongst other things, to true worship. You know, when our hearts are aligned with God in true worship, it opens up the floodgates of heaven. We're no longer in bondage to worshiping idols and the things of this world, but our hearts are fully devoted to him. And one of the ways we do that is through our giving. So let's pray today. Father, we thank you for all that you've given us. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless the givers today and that you would meet their needs. Father, if they're in need of employment or financial help, Lord God, I just pray that you would provide for them over these coming days in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that it's a great privilege to give our tithes and our offerings. And Lord, we just thank you for the great promise attached to that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, now we're going to gather around the table of communion. And if you'd like to grab some bread or biscuit and some water or juice, whatever you like, then please go and do that now, because we're going to come around the table of communion. I want to read from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. And he says in verse 23, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Verse 25 says, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Of course, that's what communion is all about. It's about remembering what Jesus has done for us. You know, I think it's easy in the business of life, just the daily grind, and we get our heads down and our tails up and we're just working and just getting into the things of each day. And it's so easy sometimes, I think, for our sense of what Christ has done for us and remembering what he's done for us. It's so easy for that to diminish In our hearts and in our minds. And of course, communion brings us right back to it and reminds us of what Jesus has done for us. So as we participate in the communion elements today, let's remember that Jesus' body was broken for us and his blood was shed for us and for the forgiveness of our sins. I wonder if you could take your emblem, whether it's a biscuit or a piece of bread, and let's eat together remembering the broken body of Jesus. Father, we thank you that Jesus took upon himself all of our sin. He hung on that cross and his body was racked with pain and torture. And he took upon himself our corruption, our sin, and all that resulted from our sin. And Father, we thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Let's drink together the cup, remembering the shed blood of Jesus for us. Father, we remember the blood of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the fact that he shed his blood for us, for the forgiveness of our sins. It says in your word that it's the cup of the new covenant in my blood. And Lord, we thank you for that new covenant. Lord, that covenant of love, of forgiveness, of new life. Lord, eternal life. And Father, we thank you for what you've won for us. And I just thank you for your healing touch upon every person, upon their hearts, upon their bodies, in their bodies and upon their relationships and every aspect of their life. Father, we pray and we receive it by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's good to celebrate communion. Well, Rebecca's going to come and bring our CYC, Children's and Youth Talk now, and sit back and enjoy Rebecca.
Good morning, everyone. I want you to ask yourself, why is the gospel good news? Today I'll be sharing on what the gospel is, why the gospel is good news, then how we can live it and share it in our lives. The word gospel means good news or the good telling. This word can be derived from Anglo-Saxon, Greek and Latin. Now, what is the gospel? We hear it a lot in our Christian community. Here is a reminder of what it is. The gospel refers to Jesus. It is the good news of his birth, death and resurrection. For it is good news to all who hear about his powerful life. Through the gospel, we are enlightened that we are no longer condemned, no longer slaves to sin. We are no longer on the path to eternal misery. Jesus died on the cross and rose again for us. He paid the fine for our sins so that we can live forever with him. This is what the gospel is: a ticket to freedom, the ultimate sacrifice, the demonstration of God's love to the whole world. The gospel is good news. We must not forget this. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 to 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. First to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last. Just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Through faith we are saved, through believing that the gospel is true. No one can ever say that the gospel doesn't relate to them, because Jesus came to save the whole world, all who believe. This is one way the gospel is active in our lives. We live every day in belief of the gospel. We praise God because he has saved us, and we await his return. The gospel is so powerful that it can save anyone who is repentant. Another way the gospel can be more prominent in our lives is if we share it. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." Jesus calls us his disciples to preach the gospel. There are so many ways to do this: by speaking to a friend or family member who isn't saved, by speaking at church, or evangelizing on the streets, even going on mission trips. But whatever you do, don't let this opportunity to share the gospel slip away. We have news of the key to heaven. Share it. There is immense power in the gospel. Don't keep it hidden all to yourself. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the gospel and the power behind it. Thank you for making a way for us to dwell with you one day. We pray that the gospel becomes even more prominent in our lives this month. Open up opportunities for us to share the good news to all. We ask this in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen.
Let's come around the Word of God, and if you have your Bibles there, please grab them and open them up. Or if you have a smartphone that you're using, do that also. We're going to have a look at a great message this morning. Good news of great joy. Good news of great joy. This month of December, we're actually looking at a theme, the power of the gospel. The power of the gospel. And so throughout this whole month, we're looking at the gospel, the good news of Jesus. And as I said, today's message is entitled, Good News of Great Joy. Good news. Who doesn't like to receive good news? We all love it when we get good news. It brightens the face, brings joy to the soul, relief to stressed emotions, and hope in time of difficulty. It might be that sought-after grade from an exam, or it might be the acceptance letter for employment, or perhaps news of a baby. That's wonderful news, isn't it? Or the big yes upon a marriage proposal. What greater moment in life is there? Or it might be something more somber, like the all clear from a doctor's report. And there are many things that bring good news, but today I want to talk about the good news of the gospel. There's a proverb, 25 verse 25 in the book of Proverbs, it says, good news from far away is like cold water to the thirsty. Good news from far away is like cold water to the thirsty. I don't know how close you feel to God at the moment. But you know, we sometimes feel that he's far away, but there's good news for you because he wants to come nigh you today. And we're talking about the gospel of Jesus Christ. At the time of Jesus' birth, and of course we're coming into this Christmas season, now we start to think about the coming of Christ, his birth. But at the time of Jesus' birth, the angels appeared to some shepherds to announce the arrival of the Saviour King. This was actually at the time of his birth. And it records, it's recorded in Luke chapter 2, verse 10, and the other Gospels also. But let's read from Luke. Just then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. Friends, I want to say to you this morning that Christianity is not about drab religion, but about good news of great joy. Good news of great joy. In Matthew's account of the visit of an angel to Joseph, the father of Jesus, he said that when he made this announcement, she, that's Mary, will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. He will save his people from their sins. That's good news, friends. You know, sometimes we feel guilty and we feel shame about our lives, but Jesus didn't come to heap more guilt upon us and heap more shame upon us like a lot of religion does. He came to set us free from our sins and the guilt and the shame that comes with that. You know, the name Jesus means the Lord is salvation. It's a short form of Joshua, the name Joshua, and from the Hebrew name Jehoshua. The name Jesus is very frequently used as a given name in Hispanic cultures today, as it was common in Jesus' time and culture. It wasn't an unusual name in Jesus' day. His title, the Christ, is also used in the sense of his name, and we see throughout the New Testament Jesus being referred to as Jesus Christ or Christ Jesus. And Christ actually means anointed one. It's from the Greek word Christos, which is actually the Greek translation of the Old Testament Hebrew word Messiah. Messiah, one who is anointed. And Jesus was the anointed Savior. You know, there have been innumerable people with the name Jesus throughout history, but only one who was the anointed Savior, as prophesied extensively in the Old Testament. You look at the Old Testament, there's more than 300 prophetic words relating directly to Jesus' life and the events surrounding his life. Quite amazing and quite remarkable, particularly when you consider that they've all been fulfilled and there are prophecies yet to be fulfilled, such as the actual second coming of the Lord. Friend, just as certainly as Jesus came the first time, he will come again. Praise God. You know, there's been a lot of research about the probability factor when it comes to those Old Testament prophecies actually being fulfilled in the life of Jesus. And I want to quote from a book. In the book Science Speaks, Peter Stoner and Robert Newman discussed the statistical improbability of one man, whether accidentally or deliberately, fulfilling just 8 of those prophecies Jesus fulfilled. The chance of this happening, they say, is 1 in 10 to the power of 17. Now, I'm not a mathematician, and that, I don't know how to work all that out, except that what that means is that it's 10 times 10 times 10 times 10, 17 times. And you're talking about 17 zeros after the number 10. So that's an astronomical figure. And the chance of one person fulfilling accidentally or deliberately just 8 of those prophecies is 1 in 10 to the power of 17. So it's impossible. It's impossible for those prophecies to be fulfilled, to be fabricated, or even to be fulfilled accidentally, which is quite remarkable. And for any person that's thinking, any person that is interested and has an interest in being honest with the truth and with the facts that are presented, for any person like that, the fact that the Old Testament prophecies were accurately fulfilled in the life of Jesus is quite remarkable and should make us all sit up and take notice. So just the prophetic element alone is good news, that this is not a book of fantasy, it's not a book of fiction, but the very prophetic words that were given millennia ago about the coming of the Saviour and the events surrounding his life were accurately fulfilled in his life. Friends, that's good news. God, you know, faith is not wishful thinking. It's not faith in faith or I hope things will work out. Biblical faith is grounded in the historic person of Jesus and his life and his work on the cross. Praise God. We could talk a lot about that, but I just find that really encouraging that Jesus was real. He fulfilled all those Old Testament prophecies, and he is the promised Messiah, not just for the Jewish people, but for all people everywhere. In fact, let's read a few Bible verses now. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind or humankind by which we must be saved." No other name. No other name under heaven given to humanity or humankind by which we must be saved. There's only one name that saves. That's the name of Jesus. Acts 2:21 says, "And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what your prior beliefs are, or what you've done in life. It doesn't matter who you are or what you've done. You call on the name of the Lord, the Bible says. That's the name of Jesus, and you will be saved, saved from your sins. Romans 10, chapter 10, verse 9 and 10 says, "If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it's with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess or confess your faith and are saved." You know, it's such a wonderful promise that when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. Praise God. Friends, that's the greatest good news there is on earth and throughout all of history. The good news is that through faith in Jesus Christ alone and in his saving work on the cross, you shall be saved. Friends, you can't earn it. Doesn't matter how good you are, we all fall short of the glory of God, the Bible says. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We cannot earn it through our own merit or good works or status or ethnicity. It doesn't matter who you are, we all fall short. We can't earn it. John 3:16 and Ephesians 2:8-9 and a host of other verses present the salvation through Christ as a free gift to us. Romans, Ephesians 2:8-9, "For it is by grace you are saved through faith, not of yourselves." It's the gift of God. And John 3:16, "For God so loved the world so that whoever would believe on him will not perish but have everlasting life." Praise God. Friend, I don't know where you're at today, but I encourage you to trust fully in Jesus Christ and receive the salvation that he won for us on the cross. I want to talk about why it's good news. Let's go into this a bit further. Why is this good news? Good news. It's good news because Jesus saves us from our sins, as we've been mentioning. You know, we deserved eternal damnation. And I won't go into all the Bible verses, but this is plainly what the Bible teaches. We deserve condemnation because of our sins. Romans 8 verse 1, I will mention, there is no, therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. He removes the condemnation of our sins because he paid the price for us. He saves us from our sins and from the curse of the law of sin and death. From the curse of the law of sin and death. The curse of the law of sin and death is that you sin, you die. That's what happened in the garden. Adam and Eve sinned and God said, you shall surely die. Separated from God, and we also die physically. So he saves us from our sins. Isn't that good news? You can't save yourself from your sins. I can't. Only Jesus can, and he did 2,000 years ago on the cross. Secondly, he reconciles us to our Father in heaven. He reconciles us. The Bible says, because of our sin, we were enemies of God. But Jesus' sacrifice, his atonement, he paid the price to reconcile us to our loving Heavenly Father. And the Lord even goes so far as to call us now his friends. Hallelujah. He's with us now forever as our Savior and our Lord, our God and our friend. Thirdly, he gives us a place in God's family forever. Wow, that's amazing. You know, people need family, and with whatever you're going through in your life at the moment, I think it's a message of great joy that God places us in his family forever. Ephesians 3:15, he's the father who is the father of the whole family, his whole family on earth and in heaven. Another reason it's good news is because Jesus triumphed over the grave, gaining us new life. He rose from the dead. He didn't just die on the cross. He rose from the dead so that we too, through faith in him, might have resurrection life. There is a day when Jesus will return and the dead will rise. There will be resurrection life manifest on that great day, and we are changed instantly upon Jesus' return. Another thing is that Jesus freed us from Satan's power, and brought us into his everlasting kingdom. Also, he won for us an eternal inheritance. You know, it's not just a ticket to heaven. The glorious inheritance that Jesus won for us on the cross is vast beyond our imagination, way beyond our ability to comprehend. Eternal life, and not only the forgiveness of sins and reconciliation with God, which is foundational, but what he brings us into is amazing. Eternal life, the new heaven and the new earth, all of the riches of God's kingdom manifest in our lives. Praise God. Bible says we're heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Revelations 8 verse 17. Friends, what Jesus has won for us on the cross is truly astonishing. He's the only one that can save. Only in his name and through faith in his name can we be saved. And what he has saved us from is the sin and the consequences of sin that was our lot. He saved us from eternal damnation, and he saved us into his family and into the wonderful inheritance that is ours through him. Praise God. Eternal life, peace with God, joy everlasting. We don't have time this morning to talk about the coming kingdom and the new heaven and the new earth, the home of righteousness and peace. Friends, the world will never be at peace until that great day of Jesus' return. But he won it on the cross 2,000 years ago for you and I. That's the message of the gospel. That's what's changed lives throughout the last 2,000 years, millions of lives. That's what's changed families. That's what has changed communities and even nations and civilizations, the very power of the gospel. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. It's quite remarkable that Paul, who wrote those words recorded in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. It's interesting that he sees the words as more than words. They're the power of God because they bring us into an understanding and a revelation and a knowledge of Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And as we receive him, something dramatic happens. Our lives are changed from the inside out. We become new creatures in Christ, as the Bible says, new people in him. We cease to be in Adam, as it were, and now we are in Christ. We were born in Adam, now we're born again in Christ, John chapter 3. And I just love talking about the gospel, because when I was around the age of 18, I think it was, I received Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And all these decades since then, I've enjoyed his fellowship and his blessing upon my life. And he's helped me through difficult times, and he never leaves me nor forsakes me. And I know that on my dying day, it's actually not a dying day, it's a graduation day where I'm graduating to be with him in person. How wonderful. Well, I've talked enough about it, but it's good news. And I encourage you to believe it, to declare it, and to stand fast in it. Amen. You know, back to the story of when the angels visited those shepherds, recorded in Luke chapter 2 there. The shepherds were terrified when the angel appeared, and I think I would have been too. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy for all the people." Good news of great joy for all the people. And I'm praying that for all those who are joining us online and for our congregation, that they would experience the great joy that comes from knowing Jesus this Christmas time. Let's focus on what he's done for us, and let's give thanks. Father, I just thank you for what Jesus has done for us on the cross. And Lord, help me never to take it for granted. Help me never to lose sight of it. Give me a deeper revelation of it. And I pray for every person watching here, particularly those that might be watching who haven't received you, Jesus, that you'd open their hearts to understand more deeply what you have accomplished for them on the cross. Lord, I pray that you'd open up our hearts more and more to fathom and understand this good news that saves, the good news that through faith in Jesus Christ, we shall be saved. Father, we thank you for it in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Well, God bless you. Join us again, 10 a.m. next week for Home Church Online, and we're on every week at that time. And if you're in our area, Christie's Beach or in the south of Adelaide, we'd love you to come to our services, 10 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. And you can actually register by going to or emailing us at info@newlifeonline.org.au. info@newlifeonline.org.au. Register, because we need to know how many people are coming to our services. Obviously, it's more difficult through this COVID season to manage all of that, so we need to know. So God bless you. I just pray God's blessing upon you. You'll have a fantastic week, and particularly if you're struggling at the moment, you would experience the very presence of God. I'm praying that for you right now, that this week you would find answers, you'd find help, you'd find God's grace for everything you're facing. And Lord, I just pray that joy would fill the hearts of all that are watching now, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, and I trust you'll have a great week. Where all my shame
shoulders. You left the stone unturned. You stepped out of that grave. Shouldered me all the way. But you left my heart through. Sin has no hold on me. The grace of me now, healed and forgiven. Look where my chains are now. Death has no hold on me. The grace of the ground. I was broken, but you love my whole heart through. Sin has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds me now. Mm-hmm.